very steps, looking out over a sea of orange in celebration of a victory. And it was not a victory of my making. It was a victory of your making. Because a few days prior, on June 25th, 2013, to be exact, you all had done something remarkable. You showed up. You showed up for something that you cared about deeply. You showed up for each other. You showed up for yourselves, for women that you knew and for women that you will never know, but with whom you shared something magical: sisterhood. Today, and though I do not do it very often, in fact, very rarely, I am wearing those same pink sneakers that I did 3 years ago. And I am wearing them not to remind you of something that I did, but to remind myself of something you did. Something you did here in this state where things have been awfully hard for an awfully long time. We live in a state where demoralization can overtake us, can sink into a degree that keeps us quiet, defeated. We've watched the systemic defunding of our public education system, the defunding of women's health care. And we have witnessed a legislature that, while it professes to care about life, ignores the living, turning a blind eye and a callous heart to children in this state through an understaffed, underfunded child welfare system that they refuse to get the support that it needs. And with a callous disregard to a maternal death rate that has doubled since women's health care funding was cut here in 2011. So, against that backdrop, it's pretty understandable that sometimes we've succumbed to the idea that our voices just don't matter. But as one of our heroes of the civil rights movement, Representative John Lewis, recently said, "You cannot be at home with something that you think is wrong. You cannot remain silent." We have shown that we have the courage to rise up against what we know to be wrong. That day in June of 2013 was one of them, and today is another. A day when we come together in community and a demand to be heard, an amazing day, a tipping point day. And I am so honored to have shared both of these days and every day in between with each and every one of you. Tell you that sometimes I cannot believe I wound up here. Just yesterday, it seems, I was this scared 18-year-old, unmarried, pregnant girl, fearing that my dreams of becoming the first person in my family to graduate from college had just come to a permanent end. Today, I am the bubby to the most beautiful 9-month-old baby girl you have ever seen. Two amazing, strong daughters, one of them the product of that 18-year-old moment of absolute and sheer terror. And I want you to know I was not always who I aspired to be along the way. Sometimes I disappointed myself, and I fear I would have disappointed all of you. When I was 33 and I ran for office for the very first time for the Fort Worth City Council, I was asked by a reporter whether I considered myself a feminist. And I'm ashamed to say that my answer was no. This, in spite of the fact that I managed to be in that very spot in my life, precisely because of the feminists who had come before me. As a child of poverty and later a young single parent in poverty, my rise was made possible because of the values that they fought for. I had access to affordable education through a community college, and there I began my rise. I had affordable, quality childcare that made it possible for me to hold down a job and go to school. And equally as important, I had healthcare and access to birth control at a Planned Parenthood clinic near my home. Healthcare and birth control that I could not have otherwise afforded. And I am absolutely sure I likely would have faced a second unplanned pregnancy if I had not had that care, and it would have completely derailed my journey. So why did I say no when I was asked whether I was a feminist? The words hadn't really formulated yet, but the best way I can explain it is that I was afraid that it categorized me somehow in a limiting way. I was afraid of what today might be called identity politics. And years later, in 2014, when I was running for governor, I was asked whether I thought I was being treated differently as a woman candidate. And let's face it, my sisters, I was a poster child for how a woman candidate is treated. Abortion Barbie, a bad mother because I balanced motherhood with getting my law degree, and yet, and again, I'm a bit ashamed to say this out loud to all of you brave, amazing women warriors. When asked whether I was being treated differently as a woman candidate, my answer was no. And why? Because like so many of us women, I had been raised to put my head down and forge ahead no matter how hard things were, and not to complain and not to whine, and that felt like it would be whining to me. But deeper than that, and what I've come to see since then, I have been conditioned to participate in my own marginalization. We all know that feeling. We've all had that moment, whether it was dismissing a sexist comment by a coworker, whether it was keeping our mouth shut when we've been objectified or worse, assaulted. When we watched a man we worked alongside and who was less competent than us rise in pay while we earned less and did more. Through it all, we have done what I did so long ago. We put our heads down, we forge ahead, we keep our mouths shut. We've worked hard no matter how great the challenge in front of us because that's what we do. But make no mistake about it, when we remain silent, we've all participated in our own marginalization. More than that, we've played a part in normalizing it. In some ways, we have been complicit in giving up our own power. Well, I don't know about you, my fellow nasty women warriors, but I have had enough. Asserted our rights to full and equal status as citizens of this country and this world, demanding passage of the Equal Rights Amendment. And when it failed to pass, we took a more piecemeal approach, one that has focused bit by bit on the issues that cobbled together could bring us to the ultimate place of parity: access to birth control, abortion, equality of pay, affordable child care, and family leave policies that recognize our need to balance family and our careers. The right to be educated in colleges across this country, free from the trauma and diminishment of sexual assault. The right to run for office to represent our values, in short, the right to be heard. We've been fighting for a long time for those bits and pieces of what are needed to achieve our larger goal of equality. And today, I think we need to reassert something important. We want it all. It is right, it is moral, and it is imperative for women, our families in this country, that we are equalized at every level, in classrooms, in executive suites, in boardrooms, in legislative bodies, in governors' mansions, and yes, in the highest elected office in the land. And the demand that it happened should not come from just women, and I am so thrilled to see so many men here today. Because this is not just a woman's issue. It's our brothers' issues as well, and not just because they have daughters, wives, sisters, and mothers, but for themselves, for the benefit that comes from living in a world where everyone lives to their full potential. It is not just a trite, quippy campaign slogan to say that when women do better, we all do better. It is absolutely true. When women are made a full part of the economy, as we should be, when minimum wage lifts, when pay is equalized, when affordable childcare is made possible, when the work we do at home is valued, when we make our own decisions about when and whether we will have children, all of that leads to an increase in our earning power, and everyone benefits from that. To me, we have just seated an administration that embraces the idea that so long as a few people at the top make a ton of money, the rest of us will benefit. It's that old voodoo idea of trickle-down economics. And what amazes me about that strategy is not only that it will continue to add to the vast income divides in this country, but that it fails to recognize something extraordinarily important. Because it's this simple, ladies. When we earn more money, when we bring more money home to our families, we put it right back into the economy. So instead of trickle-down economics for today, I'm gonna refer to it as pussy hat economics. Too. So pay us what we're worth, and that's how we'll get the economy going once again. It's 2017, and yet in many ways, equality feels further away from our grasp than ever. Our beloved Shiro, former Governor Ann Richards, disgusted to know that we are still dancing backward and in high heels, and we are still being paid less to do it. So now more than ever, each of us is needed. We are going to have to rise up and declare that we will yield no more. We will not yield to the continued defunding of women's health care. We will not yield to losing access to abortion and the right to control our own bodies. We will not yield to inequality of pay, stagnant minimum wages, lack of affordable childcare, and the absence of fair family leave. We will not yield our bodies to be objectified, assaulted, and trafficked. We will not yield to the idea that women shouldn't be leaders in every boardroom and at every elected office in this country. coming days and weeks and months, we are going to be tested as we never have been before. And we won't just be fighting to increase our right to full equality. We'll be fighting like hell to keep it from getting worse. And we're going to need to be there for each other. We come together today from many intersections. We are married, single, working women, and stay-at-home ones. We are trans and cis, hetero, bi, and lesbian. We are African American, Latina, Asian American, Indian American, and more. We are Muslim and Christian and Jewish and non-believer, and yes, a few of us are vegans too. Other tight as the precious beings that we are, each unique and beautifully different, but each with a shared story of what it means to be a woman. Chelsea Handler recently observed that as women, we've been taught to tackle rather than to climb. So let's all agree that we will stop tackling each other and start that climb against our real adversary. You know what? We have news for them. We are not a special interest group. We are not a subgroup. We are the majority in this country. From Lady Bird Johnson that inspired me. Famously shy, she was asked once how she managed to be so bold in fighting for the things that she cared about. Her answer, sometimes you have to get so wrapped up in something that you forget to be afraid. And so I'm asking you today, are you so wrapped up in your right to be a full and equal part of the world that you will forget to be afraid? Are you willing to attend town halls of your local elected officials and state officials and federal officials and demand your rights? Are you willing to in their offices, visit them where they work, and tell them that you will work to defeat them if they continue to trample on our freedoms? And better yet, are you willing to run for office yourself? Because we need you. Are you willing to do it even if you are afraid, and even if you know sometimes you're going to fail? Because let's face it, we've seen failure before and there will be more ahead. And here's the thing, friends, there is tremendous value in fighting for something important to you even when the outcome is not what you immediately hoped that it would be. You've all heard that quote from American pastor Robert Schuller. What is the one thing you would attempt to do if you knew you could not fail? His words, of course, were intended to inspire us to tap into our dreams for ourselves. But I would ask a slightly different question of you. What are you willing to fight for, even if the odds are stacked against you, even if you'll most likely lose? And in answering that, you will find what's really important to you. You will define not just your dreams, but the essence of who you are. In closing, I'm going to ask you to look up for a moment. Look up at that white statue that stands on the tippy top of our Texas Capitol. And if you've never noticed it before, perhaps surprisingly to some of you, the statue is not of a cowboy riding horseback with guns ablazing. Instead, she is a woman. In her right hand, she holds a sword lowered. And in her left hand, she raises a lone star proudly above her. She is called the goddess of liberty, porcelain white. Her eyes are large and they reflect a steely resolve. And late at night, you can look up at the goddess of liberty and see her illuminated high atop the Capitol dome. Through the wind and the rain and the brutal Texas heat, the goddess of liberty continues to stand. She stands for wisdom, for freedom, and for justice. She is a symbol of everything that we've been fighting for and what I was fighting for on that day in June of 2013 when I stood for 13 hours. Freedom and justice for women and the wisdom of lawmakers to stop making our bodies their political pawns. Successfully carried that filibuster past the midnight deadline. It was you. The thousands of women and men who were there, who'd had their own personal experiences that they wanted to share, who had listened as I read the heart-wrenching stories of so many women and their families on the Senate floor that day. There you were, demanding to be heard. And when your voices were artificially silenced through the parliamentary maneuvering that occurred that day, you rose like the goddess of liberty. With that lone star raised above her head, you stood for something, for yourselves, for each other, and for at least a moment, you understood your own power. That power is within each and every one of us. It is there every single day and in every moment, even when and mostly when we are scared. So harness it, move it forward, share it, grow it, and because of you, I have no doubt that equality will ultimately be ours. God bless you all. Thank you so much.